The title of today's message is A Jesus Journey. Good to be with you all this morning. Good morning, everybody. I want to read a letter that I saw yesterday. To begin with, it talks about an old man. He lived alone in Idaho. And what had happened is he wanted to spade his garden, but it's really hard work to spade a garden, and his only son, Bubba, had gotten sent to prison. And so the old man wrote Bubba a letter and described his problem, that he wanted to plant his potatoes, but he couldn't. And he wrote a letter saying, "I'm feeling pretty bad because it looks like I won't be able to plant my potato garden this year. I'm just getting too old to be digging up a garden plot. But if you were here, all my troubles would be over, Bubba. I know you would dig the plot for me. Love, Dad." But a few days later, he received a letter from his son. "For heaven's sake, Dad, please don't dig up that garden. That's where I buried all those bodies. Love, Bubba." The next morning at 4 a.m., FBI agents and local police showed up and dug up the entire area without finding any bodies. They apologized to the old man and they left immediately. And that same day, the old man received a second letter from his son. "Dear Dad, go ahead and plant the potatoes now. That's the best I could do under the circumstances. Love, Bubba." I love that. That's just so funny. And it has nothing in the world to do with my sermon. But anyways, I just had to tell it. Is this that funny, you know? But today we're talking about Jesus and a Jesus journey, that Jesus wants to invite you on the journey of a lifetime. And I like the interpretation where he said, God is not the kind of God that the world or the devil has made him out to be. I'm not saying exactly the way he said it, but that's the essence of what he said. The world wants us to think that God is weak or old or boring or outdated or any of those things. But listen, he's none of those things, is he? And see, God wants to take you on an adventure of a lifetime, and the captain of this trip, his name is Jesus Christ. He's not boring. He's not outdated. In fact, what he will do is he will give your life the meaning and the purpose and the reason and the passion that every single one of us want to have for life. None of us just want to go through this life having no idea why we're here. But yet, that's the predicament of the majority of people, isn't it? We're just kind of floating through life. We're not sure why we're here, what we're doing. And I'm here to tell you this morning that Jesus, the captain, wants to give you a purpose. He wants to outline to you a mission, a reason to be here that, listen, is so much bigger than us. It's a heavenly vision. It's a heavenly purpose. And listen, it's limitless. It's not according to what you can do. It's according to what he can do. And guess what? With God, all things are possible. Before I met Jesus, there's no way I'd have stood up in front of crowds and talked. Before I met Jesus, there's no way I'd have been casting vision, leading people. I was shy and introverted. I wanted to do my thing behind the scenes, and I was best off when I was alone. And God took me, and he took me because he says, "No, with me, you can do anything." Amen? Amen. He's limitless. And listen, he wants to bring you in a place that's exciting. I mean, his plan for my life has been way more exciting, way more adventurous than I was before I met Jesus. Before I met Jesus, I was predictable. You could tell what I liked, what I wouldn't like, what I would do and what I wouldn't do. But with Jesus, I started doing things that people wouldn't expect. I started saying things that they never saw in me until Jesus came into my life. Amen? He is exciting. He's not boring, but listen, he is challenging. He wants to take you places that will take you out of your comfort zone. And there's the place where we have to go. We have to be willing to be challenged. The point of being a Christian is growing to be more and more like him, of seeking out his purpose and his plan. And listen, Sir Edmund Hillary is the first guy ever climb Mount Everest. I don't think you would ask him, "Sir, did you do it because it was easy?" I don't think his answer would be yes. Anything that's worth doing is challenging, isn't it? And God wants to take you places that you never saw yourself. You couldn't imagine yourself ever doing that. He's preparing us as a church, I believe, for big challenges. But listen, so we can overcome them. He's preparing us to walk up to mountains and see them moved by faith. Can I get an amen? That's what He's preparing us for. He's not going to leave us here unequipped to face the challenges of fulfilling our purpose. And see, I could just get you stirred up and happy, but what I want to do is not that, but rather equip you to face the challenges of fulfilling your purpose, so when the mountains come in front of you, when you face the challenges, they don't crush you in defeat. Amen. And so this morning we're talking about a Jesus journey, and we're going to be talking about the life of Peter. See, to be a disciple means to be a what? A follower. And Jesus is the captain of the journey. And what are we doing? We are following Him. And probably the premier disciple that we talk about the most, his name is Peter. And I want to talk about three pivotal moments in his walk with Jesus, in his adventure with Jesus, where there were major mountains, major hurdles, major challenges. And he had to make the choice of whether to give up, run away, or step forward in faith. To face and meet and overcome those challenges, because God is calling us all. And so first of all, number one, church, we need to be able to follow the call when He calls your name. Turn in your Bibles to Luke chapter 5. Luke chapter 5. Jesus had walked down to the Sea of Galilee. And even early on when He preached, listen, Jesus never had trouble getting people to come hear Him. There was something about what He had to say because His words imparted spirit and life. And nobody had ever heard that before. And they came and drove so much that He didn't have anywhere to stand. I mean, you could imagine the seas behind Him, and they're pressing in to the point where if He goes back any further, He's going to be in the water. But there's some fishing boats there, and one of them happens to be owned by a man named Peter. Listen, there's no accidents. A lot of things that we chalk up to just circumstances, no, it's God. It just happens that Peter's boat's right behind him. And so Jesus steps into Peter's boat. And He starts to preach to the crowd from there where He has room. But it says in Luke 5:4, when He had stopped speaking, He said to Simon, "Launch out into the deep and let down your nets for a catch." This morning, some of us are in this place where God is stepping into your boat. Jesus is stepping into your life, and He's asking for access. Will you let me have it? Huh? And I'm asking you this morning, how are we reacting to the fact that God is getting involved in the details of our life? Where we thought we were in control, but He's saying, I've got something better. Huh? And He says, launch out into the deep, Peter. And verse 5 says, but Simon answered and said to Him, Master, we have toiled all night and caught nothing. Listen, nevertheless, and this needs to be one of the themes of our life, at your word. Do we have that kind of mindset that when God says, do this or say something, we say, you know what, God? I don't understand. It doesn't make sense. But I'll do it at your word. See, something that the Lord's been laying in my heart is, listen, I don't have to understand before I obey. But if I obey when I don't understand, eventually I'll see why. But if I never obey until I understand, I'll never understand. Because I'll always be living in my own plan. How many of y'all this morning are living in His plan? And how many of y'all have been waiting to act when you understand? He's saying, step out in faith. Amen. Amen? Listen, Jesus, we're going to find out, is a way better fisherman than Peter. Yep. See, there's a lot of things we think we're good at. Let me clue you in. He's better. He is better at your own occupation than you are. Whatever you're gifted at, He's more gifted at. He says, at your word, I will let down the net. In verse 6, and when they had done this, they caught a great number of fish, and their net was breaking. So they signaled to their partners in the other boat to come and help them. And they came and filled both boats so that they began to sink. And when Simon Peter saw it, look at this, he fell down at Jesus' knees saying, "Depart from me, for I am a sinful man, O Lord." See, when Jesus shows up in someone's life, they will no longer think he was just a good man. They will no longer think he was just a good teacher. When Jesus shows up in your boat, you don't think that anymore, because the presence of God becomes so thick, you know that you're in the presence of God Almighty. And see, in the church today, we have worked so hard at putting on a show, but we've forgotten that the only thing that matters is whether God's there. Amen? We've been so concerned about a crowd of people that we've forgotten that who the guest of honor is, the one who owns the house. Amen? And when Jesus shows up in the house, you don't sit there and just do nothing. He falls on his knees and says, "Depart from me. I'm a sinful man." Without the presence, there's no conviction of the Spirit. And without the conviction of the Spirit, there's no conversion. And there's a lot of people have met Jesus the teacher, Jesus the good man, Jesus the guy mama talked about or daddy talked about, but they've never had him step into the boat of their life and then be looking at him eye to eye, face to face, and realize he's not just a good teacher. This is God who's just stepped into my life. We need the presence. Verse 9 says, "For he and all who were with him were astonished at the catch of fish which they had taken. And also were James and John, the sons of Zebedee, who were partners with Simon. And Jesus said to Simon, 'Do not be afraid. From now on, you will catch men.' So when they had brought their boats to land," notice this, "they did what? They forsook all and followed him." Listen, I don't know about your life, but we need to look at our lives and say, "Have I forsaken all to follow him?" Listen, I think there's a lot of people trying to follow Jesus dragging a boat behind them. Huh? They're trying to bring the old life behind. They've got the fishing nets in the boat. They've got everything with them just in case. You don't need a contingency plan in case Jesus fails you. Amen? You don't need half of God and half of your plan. You just need to go all out for Jesus. Amen. Does anybody hear me this morning? If he's calling your name, let go of all and follow him. Because listen, he's worthy of it all. There's nothing he's asked me to give away that was worth keeping. And everything he's ever given me, he was only worthy of. But he gave it by his good grace. Jesus will make your life so much better, so much more fulfilling. He's the only one that can give you purpose and meaning. But listen, you're not going to get there dragging your old life with you. You got to leave it behind. Because listen, it's not worth it. Peter was a lousy fisherman anyways. Amen? Jesus was a way better fisherman to begin with. And listen, Jesus made him a fisher of men. He was a lousy fisher in reality, but he became an excellent fisher of men through Jesus, didn't he? Are you following me this morning, church? He will take what you're not good at, what you've been messing up anyways, take you into your purpose and calling, and all of a sudden you'll be saying, "How's all this happening? How is it that I'm here now? How is it that God is doing this?" Listen, I want you to wake up at some point in your life and have to pinch yourself saying, "How did I get here? How is this reality that God brought me to this place that I'm doing this thing now? How did I ever get here?" Amen. That's the kind of life he has for you. Not for you to just go to church, go to Wendy's, go to Walmart, and go home. Hallelujah. There's so many Christians, your life's so boring, a snail could pass you up. Come on, church. We ought to be the most adventurous, daring, courageous people on planet Earth that are moving mountains, that are shaking nations. That's what our inheritance is. Hallelujah. But when he tells us to do something, we have to say, "Yes, Lord. Whatever he commands, second thing after we follow the call, the second challenge, number two, is to follow the command. John chapter 6. Once again, Jesus is getting surrounded by even a bigger crowd. The day before, he fed 5,000 men plus women and children with 5 loaves and 2 fish. And that kind of caught people's attention. He tried to hide away, but they spent all day and hunted him down. And the crowd is numbered in who knows how many thousands of people have come out into the desert, into the wilderness, listen, to hear a preacher. What did God say this morning about hunger and thirst? I think there was a hunger and thirst, but Jesus is going to bring something out that largely they're coming because they think there's going to be dinner. How many of y'all know the way to get the biggest church service? What do you do? Huh? You feed them. And so this huge crowd comes, and it says in verse 51, Jesus, he knows that they need something more than to have their bellies full. It says in verse 51, Jesus speaking, I am the living bread which came down from heaven. If anyone eats of this bread, by the way, we're taking communion this morning. If anyone eats this bread, he will live how long? And the bread that I shall give him is my flesh, which I will give for the life of the world. In other words, he's saying, I will give my life for your lives. I will be the sacrifice that pays the price for your sin. And it says in verse 52, the Jews therefore quarreled among themselves, saying, you think people are still fighting over the gospel? He says, how can this man give us his flesh to eat? Listen, I take the Bible literally. When it's clear, it's literal. But there's times when God makes it very clear that what he's given is symbolism. And Jesus says in verse 53, then Jesus said to them, most assuredly, I say to you, unless you eat the flesh of the Son of Man and drink his blood, you have no life in you. Obviously, it's not literal. What he's talking about is this. What are you putting your trust in? What are you relying on to provide and sustain your life? See, there's natural bread, but what happens a little while after you eat? You get... And is there anything in this world that will secure our eternity? Because the truth is that we were born into eternity. And we're going to go either to the Father or we're going to go to destruction. The Bible makes it clear. And Jesus is saying, where's your source of life come from? Are you trusting in the almighty dollar? Are you trusting in things? Or are you trusting in the only one who can secure your eternity and be the sure provider for the here and now? Are you following me, church? And the way to do that is to place your faith in his death, burial, and resurrection. The fact that he gave his life, his flesh for ours, that he poured out his blood that we might be cleansed of our sin. Are you following me, church? See, they quarreled over this. What are we trusting in? And verse 60 says, therefore, many of his disciples, when they heard this, said, this is a hard saying. Notice these next three words, four words. Who can understand it? What did God say earlier? You don't have to understand God in order to obey God. Listen, there's a lot of people who are locked up in what they understand. You are going to have a challenging life if you spend your whole life trying to understand the Almighty. Did you hear that? His ways are so higher than our ways. His thoughts are so higher than our thoughts. We will never completely understand him. We will always be learning more, even in heaven. Did you hear that? You don't have to understand. And I want you to be free from that this morning. But you do need to trust and obey. And listen to verse 61. When Jesus knew in himself, his disciples complained about this and said to them, he said to them, does this offend you? Jesus said in Matthew 11, blessed is he who is not offended in me. Listen, every time you read this word, every time you hear a sermon out of this word, there is a spot, I guarantee you, there will be a place in that sermon where God will allow a hurdle. there will be an obstacle that you read or you heard that preacher say out of the Word, and there will be something that rises up in your flesh that will think, I don't like that. I don't want to do that. I've never heard that before. Listen, this is the biggest one. That ain't what Mama said. It's true, isn't it? And our choice will be to whether carry a spirit of offense or to say, God said it at your word. Because at that moment, the obstacle is removed. Unfortunately, there's a lot of folks that won't move the obstacle. It says in verse 66, from that time, many of his disciples went back and walked with him no more. Anybody out there know someone who used to be in church, used to be on fire for God, and they decided, I'm no more of this? I dare you to find one that isn't carrying offense. And I'm compassionate about that. I have been there. But listen, we have to choose to not walk in the offense. We're all going to get hit with an offense, aren't we? The word offense means a stumbling block. It means something to make you fall. And I've hit my nose before. And I had to make a choice. Am I going to stay here face planted? Or am I going to get back up? Am I going to forgive? Am I going to choose to let God handle the situation? Am I going to go on in the calling and the purpose and the plan for my life? Or am I going to get face planted and just lay in the ditch the rest of my life? Amen. You may follow me this morning. And maybe you're there this morning. And God's saying, I'm giving you this word so you can get up this morning. Amen. See, because Jesus then said to the 12, do you also want to go away? But Simon Peter, remember we're talking about Peter, he answered him, Lord, to whom shall we go? You have the words of eternal life. You're the only one that gives my life any reason, any purpose, any power. Before I met you, I was a mess. I don't have anywhere else to go. There are no alternatives to Jesus. He is the way, the truth, and the life. There is no one else who died on the cross for your sins. There is no one else who was sinless so he could die on the cross for your sins. There is no one else who is God so he could come up from the grave. Is someone alive in the house this morning? There is an offense to the gospel, but the offense is in us, not in him. Did you hear that? His love is perfect, and it sets us free. He says in verse 69, also we have come to believe and know that you are the Christ, the Son of the living God. His words are spirit and they are life. And only Jesus sets us free. Only Jesus can have a plan for our life that gives us meaning and purpose. Only Jesus can secure a home in heaven for us. Only Jesus makes any sense of this life. Are you hearing me this morning, church? See, Jesus came, and what the scriptures say is to just trust in the Lord with all of our heart and not lean on what? Our own understanding. But in all our ways, just acknowledge him. God, you're God. I don't get it. I don't understand it, but I'm going to follow you. And I know that you will direct my paths. You will take me where I don't understand. You will solve situations that looked impossible. You will answer questions in time that I don't have the answers to. You are God Almighty. And I can trust you with everything. As Adam said through the interpretation this morning, God is on the throne. He is in control. And we can trust him alone. Amen, church. See, what he did is he not only saved us to take us to heaven. But listen, while we're here, he called us to take people with us to heaven. Amen. Did you hear that? He saved you to secure your home. But he called you to take others home with you. Hallelujah. I don't want to go to heaven and know nobody. Did you hear that? I don't want to go to heaven and there be no evidence that I ever lived on earth. Did you hear that? I don't want to just eat and breathe warmed up a church pew, sang some songs, and died one day. I want to look around and see that person would have fallen away if it wasn't for that encouraging word. This person would have died young if the Lord hadn't have moved through our prayers and healed them. This person, their marriage would have split. This person would have walked away from God and God brought them back. This person was lost, but Jesus found them through my testimony. That's what we want to do. Amen, church. Your life has eternal purpose. You have a calling. He called you, He's commanded you, but He's placed a calling on your life. The third obstacle we've got to face is to follow our calling. The calling of God. And listen, you all have a calling. It's not relegated to just the pastor. But if He called you to save you, He's called you into the ministry. You have a ministry, you have a purpose. See, Peter, listen. He was human like us to the point where he denied Jesus. And I don't know about you, but if I examine my life, I'm no better. Anybody here ever had the opportunity to witness and you bit your tongue? I mean, the door was wide open and you've been around people that weren't believers and you didn't want to feel out of place. You didn't want an awkward moment. Anybody know what I'm talking about? You didn't want to break that ice and bring Jesus into the conversation. We've all denied Jesus. And see, the thing that the enemy wants to do when we miss it, and we all have and we all do, is then the enemy wants to swoop in. Listen, don't lose me now. And he wants to preach the gospel of you are disqualified. You've messed up too much. You've gone too far. You've done too much. He comes in with that condemnation, doesn't he? But how many of you all know Romans 8:1 says, now there is no condemnation to those who are in Christ Jesus. You'll remember that Peter, he denied Christ three times and he thought it's over. What did Peter do before he got saved? What was his job? We looked at it. Come on, you can at least follow the sermon from Luke 5. What was he doing? Fishing. He was a fisherman. A couple of you get A's. Amen. And after he thought he's disqualified, what did he go back to? Yeah. He went back to fishing. Look in John chapter 21. He and some of the other disciples, they're back to fishing. I think they felt like it was over. They'd messed up. They'd gone too far. And they look out on the shore and they see a man there cooking fish. It's early in the morning. In other words, he's making breakfast. How many of y'all know when God shows up, he always wants to commune with you? Even when we've done something we shouldn't. He never shows up hateful. He always shows up wanting to reestablish the relationship. He's not standing on the shore with his whip ready. Are you hearing me? Some of y'all think that's God. No, Jesus is waiting on the bank for us to just come over and eat with him. He even has already made breakfast. Or in our case, it's a good lunch. But you got to wait for a few minutes. In John 21, it says that the man was standing. They didn't realize who it was, but Peter did. And he said, it's our Lord. And he's so excited that Jesus hasn't left him. The rest of them are trying to get the catch of fish in that, by the way, Jesus had directed them to again, because once again, they never caught anything without him. But Peter can't wait. And you know what he does? He takes off his outer garment and jumps in the water and swims as fast as he can to get back to Jesus. And I don't know exactly what he expected to happen. I think maybe he expected at least that his home in heaven was secure. But I don't know that he expected necessarily to enter in back into his calling. There's a lot of you all that think that God could never use you now like he would have. And I'm here to tell you that God majors in turning your mess into a ministry. Amen. And so he looks at Simon Peter alone, just one-on-one. He says, so when they had eaten breakfast, Jesus said to Simon Peter, Simon, son of Jonah, Notice how he words this. Do you love me more than these? If you remember when on the night Jesus was betrayed, what did Jesus say? Even if everyone else denies you, I will never, Lord. I'll follow you to death. In other words, there was a pride in him that maybe he was a little better. Are you with me this morning? I think anytime we start to think that we're a super Christian, we're setting ourselves up for a fall. Huh? And he says, Peter, do you really love me more than these guys? And he said to him, yes, Lord, you know that I love you. And Jesus then, for the first time, reinstates his calling, then feed my lambs. I think some of us need God to show up and reaffirm the fact that we are lovers of Jesus. Jesus didn't ask Peter that because he didn't know the answer. He asked Peter that because Peter needed to come back to that reality himself, that he hadn't gone too far. See, the enemy wants to convince you because you messed up, because you went after something of the world, you don't love God anymore, therefore. But that's not the case. There is still that love there, and Jesus knew it, and he wanted Peter to come back to the reality, listen, of his first love. Am I speaking to someone this morning? God just wants you to come back to the reality of who's number one, of who you love and adore. So Peter says, yes, I love you. And so Jesus says, then tend my sheep. In verse 16, he said to him again a second time, Simon, son of Jonah, do you, and he doesn't say love me more than these, do you love me? And I think in a sense he's saying, not only do you, I'm not just asking you to love me more than these, do you have a personal one-on-one love for me? And of course, what does Simon say once again? Yes, Lord, you know that I love you. And he said to him again, what, church? Tend my sheep. He's reaffirming his call. What? Twice now. He's reaffirmed the relationship twice and the call twice. I believe great now God is reaffirming relationship and calling. Verse 17, he said to him the third time, Simon, son of Jonah, do you love me? And listen, Peter was grieved because he said to him the third time, do you love me? How many of y'all like to revisit painful places in your life? None of us do, do we? None of us want to go back and visit our mistake, visit where we veered off. And this is painful for Peter. But what is it doing? It's bringing freedom. Did you hear that? The Bible says that he who what confesses his sin and forsakes them shall obtain mercy. Did you hear that? Are you following me this morning? Jesus is taking Peter to this spot, though it grieves him, so he can be set free from it. Are you following me here? See, a lot of you in the middle, once again, this is going to be a stumbling block. You get in the Word, you get in a sermon, and a lot of it's uplifting you. But I guarantee you, if the anointing is there, you will hit a stumbling block of something that bites a little bit. And the choice will be then either to just make that go away, or to get honest with God and say, God, you're right. And realize that he's not bringing up that thing to make you feel discouraged. He's bringing it up to set you free from it. That past hurt, that past mistake, that thing in your life that isn't God's perfect will, he brings it up so you can be set free. Can I get an amen, church? And so Jesus, he said to him, Lord, you know all things. You know that I love you. And Jesus said for the third time, feed my sheep. Most assuredly, I say to you, when you were younger, you girded yourself. In other words, you put on your clothes, you walked wherever you wanted to. But when you're old, you will stretch out your hands and another will gird you and carry you where you do not wish. It's a strange way into our ears of saying, Peter, right now you get to direct your life in a sense. You've lived your life a free man, but one day they're going to arrest you. And listen, how many of you all know how Peter left this world? He left this world in honor. There will be challenges. What we understand is that Peter was taken to be crucified himself because of his stand for the gospel, because he fed God's sheep, because he tended his lambs, because he tended his sheep. The world didn't like it. They weren't impressed. And listen, Peter never stopped. Nothing could hold him back because he knew who loved him and he knew what his calling and his purpose was. And he had a fire in his bones that the world, listen, will never be able to put out. And so they took him to crucify him. And you know what he said? I'm not worthy to die like my Lord. Crucify me upside down. And they did. And he got a direct ticket to glory. If I preach a gospel that's just about the only about the here and now, you won't live with heaven in view. And also don't want to preach a gospel that only talks about heaven, because then you won't know how to live in the kingdom now. Are you following me? But you have to keep heaven in view. Peter lost nothing. That day, he graduated. Amen? Amen. Summa cum laude, if you know what that means. He had a 4.0 when he got to heaven, I think. Despite everything he had done wrong, because God turned even his mistakes and turned around and worked them to good and used him mightily. And notice this in verse 19. Then he spoke, signifying by what death he would glorify God. And when he had spoken this, he said to him, what, church? Follow me. Follow me. What he's saying is, Peter, no matter what the cost, no matter what happens, no matter what you face, no matter what challenges, whether it's to your call, whether it's to obeying the command of God, whether it's the enemy trying to rip your calling away from you, he said, just follow me. Just trust and obey. Just keep living with these words, at your word, God. I will do it. Are you with me, the church? Follow Jesus on this adventure. It's not complicated. If we just keep him in view. And guess what Peter looked around and said? He said, but what about John over here? And Jesus looked at Peter and he said, what does it matter to you if I come back before he ever dies? In other words, listen, don't let your calling be contingent upon what the person next to you is doing. Huh? Don't let the enemy rob you of your purpose and plan because you look at someone else and theirs looks better. Or theirs looks easier. Listen, just follow Jesus. And now what Jesus said to him after he looked at Peter one more time and he said, just follow me. If we could just boil down our lives to those two words, follow Jesus. Follow Jesus. And listen, you will live a life that you never imagined. The prophet Elijah went to find someone to mentor, and he took his mantle off, which kind of looked like a poncho, and it represented the call and anointing of God. And he walked up to a boy that's just plowing a field, and he throws it on him. And the boy knew what it meant. He knew that it was God calling him into ministry. And for a second, he thought, well, let me go tell my parents goodbye. And Elijah looks at the young man and says, I haven't done anything. In other words, I didn't call you. God did. And the man left after he made a sacrifice to God. And he left all and he started to follow the plan of God for his life. And this guy went from basically being a potato farmer, not there's anything wrong with that, but within a few years, he was walking up to rivers and seeing them split in half. He was walking up to mountains and seeing fire coming down and consuming. He was walking around seeing the dead raised to life. He was watching axe heads float up out of the water. He was watching all these things happen. God was giving him visions and dreams. His life went on the wildest adventure that he could never imagine. His name is Elisha, and before he met Jesus, his life was boring. Predictable. But listen, he faced the challenges of the call of God on his life, and his life opened wide up. I'm telling you this morning, do not waste your life on boring things that don't matter. I'm telling you this morning that your life does not just have to be, I took air, I lived somewhere, and one day I went to heaven. God has so much more for you, but there's going to be roadblocks. Despite the fact that it's so exciting, it's so adventurous, it's a life that you can never imagine, it also has challenges that you won't see all of them ahead of time. There will be difficulties. There will be adversity. And I'm looking across you this morning, and I'm asking you, what are the roadblocks that you're hitting right now? Are they financial? Are they in your own spirit over your own mistakes? Are they in your own will of whether you're saying, do I really want to go after God with everything? Do I really want to forsake all and follow Him? Maybe there are questions in your mind. You want God to lay out all the answers. Listen, the only answer you need is Jesus. He's the answer to all your questions. Maybe it's fear of the unknown. Anybody ever been in that camp? I know I have. Like, God, I don't know about this. And how about failure? Even the enemy reminds you of what you did before. Do any of those things disqualify you? And this is what I see this morning at these altars. It's like Jesus showing up on the shoreline for Peter. And how many of y'all know that the communion is about spending time and connecting with God? Jesus this morning is at these altars in a sense. And He's got the meal ready. And He's saying, you don't even have to wait for the rest of the fish, rest of the fishermen to come in. You can jump off the boat right now. And when you come to Him, he's not gonna be mean, He's not gonna be hateful, He's gonna be so thankful you're there. Because He's been waiting on this shoreline, I don't know how long. It's just right now this morning, it's getting pointed out. And He's just saying, follow me. Are you with me this morning, church? He's calling us to a higher calling and a higher plane, to live on a level that we could have never imagined. And He's got everything ready right now. And as the anointing's here this morning and the word's being preached, I beg of you this morning, don't let the enemy make you offended. But instead, be encouraged that the one who's calling your name is calling you because He has love and restoration for you. No matter what's happened, no matter what you face, no matter what you're up against in this moment, He's bigger. And He has the answers. And He has a plan for your life that's so much bigger than what you could ever imagine. I want to invite our worship team this morning to go ahead and go to the altars, go to the platform. But these altars are open this morning, church. Let's go ahead and stand. I want to see, my prayer is to see some Peter hearts this morning that just can't wait to get to Jesus. Hunger for Him. A thirst for Him. Listen, nothing else in this world is going to satisfy you. Nothing else. Your plan won't satisfy you for your life. Only Jesus satisfies. Hallelujah. Follow Jesus. And submit your life to His calling and His plan and His purpose.